Now, I understand that you want to marry my daughter.
That's right, yeah, yeah.
Yes, you realize, of course, that Rosamond is still rather young.
Daddy, you make me feel like a child.
Oh, yeah, you know, get them when they're young. Ain't no
Well, I'm sure you'll know what I mean, Mr.
Shabby. Ken Shabby.
Mr. Shabby, I just want to make sure that you'll be able to look after my daughter.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I'll be able to look after her, I suppose.
And, what job do you do?
Or clean out public lavatories.
Is there a promotion involved?
Oh, yeah, yeah. After 5 years, they give me a brush. Yes. Oh, I'm sorry, Squire, I gobbed on your carpet.
And where are you going to live?
Well, round at my grand's. She trains polecats. But most of them are suffocated, so there should be a bit of spare room in the attic, eh? You know what I mean?
And when do you expect to get married?
Oh, right away, sport, right away, you know? Oh, I haven't had it for weeks.
Well, look, I'll phone the bishop and see if we can get the abbot.
Oh, Dory!
The story so far. Rosamond's father has become ensnared by Mr. Shabby's extraordinary personal magnetism. Bob and Janet have eaten Mr. Farquhar's goldfish during an Oxfam lunch, and Mrs. Elsmore's marriage is threatened by Doug's insistence that he is on a different level of consciousness. Louise's hernia has been confirmed, and Jim, Bob's brother, has run over the editor of The Lancet on his way to see Jenny, a freelance pagoda designer. On the other side of the continent, Napoleon still broods over the smouldering remains of a city he had crossed half the earth to conquer, whilst Mary, Roger's half-sister, settles down to watch television.